Sabbath, and welcome to another Children's Church worship experience. I hope you had a good week, and you're excited to praise God with us today. But before we learn more about Him, let us pray. Bow your heads and close your eyes. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for waking us up this morning to see another day. Forgive us of all our sins. Help us to be blessed by church service today. Continue to bless us, guide us, and protect us. Thank you for all that you do. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello, my name is Kaden Powell. Today I will be reciting Isaiah 1, verse 18. Though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be white as snow.
Boys and girls, it is always great to be with you as we continue to grow together. As we prepare for our message, there's a song that I've been singing and humming all week, and I hopefully you guys are in the habit of humming songs that uplift you. So I want to introduce to you this song. Your parents probably know it. Some of you might be the first time, but just enjoy the song with me. It basically says that I need you to survive. Enjoy. Boys and girls, friends stay in touch with each other. And especially in this quarantine time, it's so much more important for friends and family, classmates at school to stay in touch. And there's so many ways to do it. But here at Miracle City Church, we want to encourage and invite you to stay in touch with us. And so boys and girls, with your mom and dad's permission, we are inviting you to connect with us by simply emailing us at children@miraclecitychurch.org. Again, our email address is children@miraclecitychurch.org. And there you'll have an opportunity to email us about what's happening with you, probably to share with us your date of birth, exciting things that are happening in your life, and sometimes even opportunities for us to pray with you. Recently, one of our family members, Nicholas McFall, he injured his ankle and he had to undergo surgery. And so because we are aware of that, as a family, we get to pray for him. And so could you join me as we pray? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your mercy and your grace and your abundance in our lives. Right now, God, we bring in before you our friend, our brother, Nicholas McFall, who, God, underwent surgery and he injured his ankle. But we know that you are the God of healing. You're the God of complete restoration. We ask, oh God, that you do that for Nicholas and so that he's even stronger and faster and more trusting than he was before the injury.
And give him strength when he is in pain and help him to remain you. Please forgive us of all of our sins and just thank you for always blessing us and making a way out of no way, dear Heavenly Father. Help him to continue to have faith and trust in you, and as he recovers, and help him to be surrounded with support and love. In Jesus' name.
Be with the boys and girls and bless us to this end. And we give you all glory and praise. In Jesus' name, amen. So boys and girls, we encourage you, please share with us, children at miraclecitychurch.org. We want to hear from you, and I promise you, if you email us, we will certainly reconnect with you. Here we go. Ready? When I say go, then we'll start. Ready? Go. I hope you had fun, all right?
Hooray! I did it!
Hello, my friends. I want to talk to you today about something very bad, but very good. In Isaiah chapter 53, the prophet describes what was going to later happen to Jesus, our Savior. It says, "Surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds, his stripes, we are healed." Right before Jesus died, he sat down with all of his friends called disciples, and he took this bread like what's behind me here, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Eat this in remembrance of me." And then he took a cup like this cup that has the grape juice in it, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you." He said, "Drink this in remembrance of me." And then later, that same night, he went to pray. He was arrested. And the next day, he hung on the cross and died. As they crucified him, he remarkably said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." He died begging for the forgiveness of the people who were killing him. And we also should have the same attitude towards those who do us wrong, forgiving them. Why? Because Jesus' body was broken for us. His blood was spilled for us. Because he's given us forgiveness, we should be willing to give that forgiveness to others. And so, my friends, I want all of you to remember these wonderful things. It was the Lord's will to bruise Jesus in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 10, and to cause him to suffer so that we could have forgiveness of our sins. Why not extend that forgiveness to others?
Boys and girls, it's always great to connect with you as we study and grow together. If you recall, last week we looked at, and I'll encourage you now to get your Bibles. Please go get your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 5, and we'll start again from verse 17. And I'm actually going to read from the New International Version, but whatever version of the Bible you have, that's okay. Luke chapter 5, and we're reading again from verse 17. But last week we were looking at friendship. We were looking at friendship, but not just any old friendship, but friendship through the lens of King Jesus, right? Well, let's read together from verse 17, Luke chapter 5. "One day Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem, and the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus." Well, verse 19 says, "When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on his mat, threw the tiles into the middle of the crowd right in front of Jesus." And we studied, and from the passages we read last week, we remember that friends and friendship is about carrying others. Well, if we continue with what we've been studying, we'll see that friends don't just carry them, but we carry each other all the way. The men could not get their paralyzed friend to Jesus because there was a great crowd. So they went up the roof, and we went up the roof last week, but they ripped the tiles of the roof open and then let the man down on his mat in the middle of the room. Man, we don't just carry each other as friends. We carry each other to the very end. Well, today we want to look at another part of friendship. And so to do that, let's continue reading. We will read verse 20 together. Are you guys ready? Let's read together. Verse 20. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." When Jesus saw the energy, the effort, the faith that the men had to do whatever it took to take their friend for healing to Jesus, Jesus didn't first heal his body. He healed his spirit. He healed his soul. He said, "Friends, your sins are forgiven." Boys and girls, today, friends forgive each other. You know, sometimes I've as a grown person, I know it's hard many times to forgive because people hurt you, they abuse you, and sometimes it's not even the first time. They do things that aren't nice, things you didn't prefer or expect, or rather they not do. And so how do we just forgive them? Well, listen, if we're trying to be like Jesus, let's just understand that Jesus, he forgave those who hurt him. And because of that, we have salvation. But more than forgiving others, could I encourage you to start thinking and practicing forgiving yourself? Forgiving yourself for some of the things that you should not have done. Forgiving yourself because of how you think. And that's the devil's plan to just keep you sad and guilty and keep replaying those things in your mind that keep you burdened. Forgive yourself. Forgive yourself. You know, there's a great philosopher or a great thinker. His name is Plato. And this is what he says about forgiveness. He said, "It's easy to forgive a child of the dark." That's a natural thing, that it's dark. It's easy to forgive a child of the dark. But the real tragedy, and this is for you grown-ups, the real tragedy of life is when men are afraid of the light. It's easy to forgive a child of the dark, but the real tragedy, grown-ups and children, is when we're afraid of the light, when we're afraid to walk in God's grace, when we're afraid to do what's right. The Bible says in Luke chapter 5, verse 20, that when Jesus saw the faith of the friends, he told the man, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." Boys and girls, let's continue to be friends who carry each other and are forgiving. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you are a friend, and we thank you that we're learning so much as we spend time together. Now give us the energy, the strength, and your Holy Spirit to put it into practice and so become more like you. God, you don't want to save the pretend us. You want to save the real us. So God, we're here today saying we really need more of you and we need your grace. Thank you for being our friend. In Jesus' name, amen. Boys and girls, as we continue to meet in this special time and as we continue to bond and grow together, you know, I've heard people say things like, you know, go jump in a lake. And many times when they do that, it's actually because they want to put you down. They don't mean anything good, don't mean anything positive. Go jumping a lake is the same as saying, just get out of the way. Well, today is a beautiful day to jump in the lake. Boys and girls, remember that Jesus loves you first, Jesus loves you best, and Jesus loves you always. Jump in the lake.
At Miracle, we exist so that people will experience the miracle of life in Jesus Christ. And we have four values that we believe help us to live that miracle. They're simple. We want you to experience love, commit to learn, rise to lead, and then choose to live.
No matter how great my week may have been, one of my favorite times of the week is noon on Saturdays. That's when I get to meet up with my family at Miracle City for our worship experience. From the time I receive a hug from the greeters at the bottom of the stairs when I enter the building, to when I walk back to my car after service, the love of Miracle City surrounds me. When I first got to Miracle, knowing that there were people who were happy to see me, remembered my name, and were genuinely interested in getting to know me, made me want to keep coming back.
And then we have our worship service, which really just brings you in and just opens up your heart and your spirit so you can be receiving of the word. And it's just the love that you feel here. Miracle is filled with love, and that's the main draw for me. You feel a part of a family.
There's also lots of love for children at Miracle. Our children's worship services teach me about Jesus through music, games, crafts, and Bible stories. I love playing with my friends and learning about Jesus.
Church is about growing my relationship with Jesus. My small group CORE really helped me with that. I'm a member and leader of CORE, our young adult group here at Miracle City, and CORE stands for Connect, Obey, Restore, and Elevate. Our group provides a place for young adults to grow spiritually and socially. One of the reasons I love CORE is that it provides a safe place for us young adults to have practical Bible study as well as genuine fellowship. CORE is also where I have made some of my best friends.
To be in a young adult group where there's a lot of people my age who are doing similar things that I'm doing and was still like spiritually active and searching for God and trying to develop a relationship with God was pretty cool to me.
At Miracle City, we're taught that every person has gifts and abilities that God wants to use for His glory. Growth Track is a reoccurring four-week session where we learn about our own spiritual gifts, identify our personal gifts, and then rise to lead in that capacity.
So many people struggle with understanding what their purpose is and whether there is a place for them at church. Now, at Miracle, we believe that leadership is influence. Nothing more, nothing less.
At Miracle City, we've discovered that living your best life happens when serving others. Once you go through Growth Track and you know what your gifts are, it's easy to know where you should serve. A lot of people think serving happens on the praise team or by being an elder, but there are so many other ways and so many other things that you can do to serve others and serve God.
There are so many ways to serve at Miracle. I'm more of an introvert, but I love keeping things running. I love details. They bring me so much joy, and it's been phenomenal to be in a place where my personality and my passion can be expressed freely. And Miracle has shown me that the way to do that is to make a choice to live my life, making a difference in the lives of others.
So look, I want to invite you to experience the miracle of Jesus Christ for yourself by attending a worship experience, by connecting in one of our grow groups, by discovering your purpose through Growth Track, or by living your best life by serving on a ministry team. Look, I promise you, you will not regret it.
Good afternoon, Miracle City. How are you? How is everyone? I'm Bridget Hines, and I'm delighted to be with you today for worship. You know, praying together, singing, and enjoying a wonderful sermon. These are the delights of Miracle City, and I hope today you will share it with someone on your social media feeds. Instagram, Facebook, Twitter. Go tell someone and invite them to join us. If you're not on social media, then why not send an email or a text? Let them know anyway. You know, our pastor, Franklin, has been letting us know that there's an exciting occasion happening next week, July 25. That of our online communion service. And you know, I don't know about you, but I am delighted and I'm excited by it, and I'm looking forward to it. There are other times when we worship together, and one of those is on Wednesday night at 8. That's our prayer time, when elders and prayer warriors pray for us and pray with us. Well, how would they know what to pray for? Why not let them know by sending a message or your prayer requests to prayer@miraclecitychurch.org and then join them on Wednesday.
I'm Gabrielle Barnes, and you probably expect me to talk about giving now, don't you? I switched it up this week. If you haven't gotten an email from us about the communion service that Bridget mentioned, that means you're not signed up to receive our newsletters. It's really easy. Just head over to miraclecitychurch.org/stay in touch, give us your email address, and we'll make sure that you're up to date with everything happening at Miracle. Another way to stay connected with us is to make sure you're following us on social media. We're on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube at Miracle City Church. If you're visiting with us today, Pastor Franklin is in the middle of a series about Ephesians 6:14-15. You can catch up on all of the previous sermons on our YouTube channel. Now, last but not least, we'd like to give you the opportunity to say thank you to God for His blessings and to support our ministry with your gifts. You're under no obligation to give. God encourages cheerful giving, and so do we. If you do want to give, you have several options. You can visit miraclecitychurch.org/give and give using your debit card. You can use PayPal. The email address is treasurer@miraclecitychurch.org. You can text your offering. Send the amount you want to give to 84321. If you haven't texted before, there are a couple of steps to get it set up. After that, it'll be a one-step process. For those of you who still write checks, you can mail those to us. All of this information is on the screen, but if you forget, you can just go to miraclecitychurch.org/give, and you'll find instructions for each of our giving methods there. I'm so happy you decided to join us this week. If you have any questions about anything that happens during the service, just ask us in the chat and we'll be happy to help you. Welcome to Miracle City Church. Enjoy our worship experience.
We're going to declare today that our God is great and greatly to be praised.
Ashes. Let's bow our heads as we pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come before you today, God, and we are so grateful. We're so grateful that you are still in control. We are so grateful for your protection We are so grateful that you've brought us safely through another week, God. We are so grateful, though, for Jesus. God, we thank you for Jesus in a special way today, because your word declares that there is nothing stronger than Jesus. It says that it is the only name given among men whereby we can be saved. And so that also means that we can be saved from our troubles. We can be saved from our cares, including, God, coronavirus. So God, today we ask that you would send your Holy Spirit to be in our midst, to be the God that unites us, to be the God who sits outside of time and space and who's not limited by anything but himself, and therefore is well able to meet each person at their point of need, where they need it, when they need it, even right now. So God, today we invite you into this worship service. We ask that you would be with those who are sick, especially those who are suffering with the effects of coronavirus, be it the financial effects, be it the psychological effects, be it the physical effects in their body, or the emotional effects from the loss of a loved one, or just the struggle just associated with this very perilous and trying time. We ask that you would heal us. God, we ask for those who are sick in other ways, God, who are struggling with just a multitude of illnesses, God, and things that we don't know all the details, but we are excited that the Holy Spirit knows and numbers, God, the hairs on our head. So, God, we know that you are concerned and you care, and so we just lift up every prayer request, every petition, every person under the sound of my voice, God, I pray that you would draw near to them in a special way. God, we also lift up the speaker today and our lead pastor, David B. Franklin. We thank you for the man of God that he is. We thank you that his heart is consistently turned towards you. And we thank you that you continue to speak to him. We ask that you would be with the speaker, that you would even now prepare our hearts for the word that we will receive. Make our hearts fertile ground, God. Help the seed that is about to be sown not to fall on sandy ground or rocky ground, but soil that is well pricked and well prepared to receive it, and then that you will water it, nurture it, and then that we might prepare, not prepare, but that we might produce much fruit. God, we thank you. We thank you that we are alive to see today. We are more than 4 months into quarantine, God. And though many have been infected, many have been healed. God, though many have lost jobs, you have kept more than with nothing than you they when they had everything. And so, God, we choose, God, to take your perspective that you are the God who is well able to work all things together for the good of those who love you and are called according to your purpose. And so, God, we invite you once again to be in our hearts, in our minds, in our lives, in our situations, in our circumstances, God. And then, God, once you are involved, we understand that you plus us is the majority. So we thank you, God, for being a present help in trouble. We thank you for being Jehovah Jireh, our provider. We thank you for being Jehovah Rapha, our healer. We thank you that everything we need is found in you, including the forgiveness of our sins. And so we ask that you would finally do that. Wash us once again in the blood of Jesus, God. Present us faultless before the throne with exceeding joy, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen.
What a mighty God we serve. Angels bow before him. Heaven and earth adore him. What a mighty, mighty God we serve. I'm so glad that you are with us today as we share in this virtual worship experience. God is King and he is worthy to be praised. And I'm glad you're lifting your voice already in this worship experience. I'm Pastor David B. Franklin, lead pastor here at Miracle City Church. And our mission statement simply says that we exist so that people will experience the miracle of life in Jesus Christ. We are just committed to that mission. We're not giving up on it because we know that God has called us as a people to experience the miraculous life that is only found in him. And I want to share that with everybody I know and everybody that I can reach. And I hope that you do too.
Well, we're going to get into the Word of God today, but there's just a couple things I want you to remember. The first thing is, I haven't said it in a few weeks, but I need to remind you, every single week at 11:45, we have our Miracle City Kids worship experience. You can't afford to let your kids miss it because it is an absolute blessing. Spiritual lessons, fun, songs. It's just really a time of enjoyment for our kids here at Miracle City. So please, if you have children up through the ages of 12, we want to invite you to ensure that they are watching, connecting, and participating in our Miracle City Kids worship experience. And then if you have youth, please, please, our youth are continuing to meet on Saturday mornings and as well as every other Friday evening. Plus, the Pathfinders are going to get back up, back started again this upcoming fall. And so you need to be connected to all that is happening. There's even more going on in our youth ministry that I didn't just mention. And so you want to make sure that you are having your youth connect into those experiences. And if you're wondering exactly how to make that happen, send an email to youth@miraclecitychurch.org and they will provide all the information to you. Okay, well, coming up, you've heard me talk about it, and we've got one more week to go. But coming up next week, I'm so excited. I'm just blessed because we are going to share in a communion experience together. You got to be part of this thing. You got to be part of it because communion is this rich time where we're able to come together. We're able to seek forgiveness for our sins. We're able to remember the great sacrifice that the Lord has provided to us. And we are able to do it together as a body of believers. Now, of course, this communion experience is going to be different than some of the ones that we have had in the past, but I believe it will be equally as meaningful. And so I'm inviting you to now prepare yourself. Over the last several weeks, we've been sending out emails about how you can, what the Bible means about examining yourself and what the Bible means about humility. What is the purpose of humility and how is it realized in our lives? In fact, just yesterday, we sent out an email communication. So if you're not getting those emails, please go to miraclecitychurch.org/stay in touch. miraclecitychurch.org/stay in touch. Sign up for our newsletter so that you can get this very important information. One of the things that we released yesterday was a recipe for communion bread. If you want to make communion bread, I know some of y'all want it to be as authentic as possible. Well, we have a recipe for you that doesn't include yeast. It's very simple, some flour, some oil. And if you'd like that recipe and you're not signed up for our emails, then please sign up and also send an email to admin@miraclecitychurch.org. Again, that's admin@miraclecitychurch.org. We'll make sure that you get that recipe. Now, of course, you don't have to make it yourself. There's something called matzah crackers that you can go out and purchase that don't have any yeast, or mitzvah kosher crackers that don't have any yeast in them. And you can go and grab those. And then, of course, organic, pure grape juice to represent the wine is what you want. But however you do it, my goal is that you participate. I've had some folks send me pictures, Pastor, I ordered from the Christian Resource Store and I got my official communion emblems ready. And that's beautiful. But if you can't do that, make sure you're participating in some way, because what's most important is that you are preparing your heart, you're preparing your mind and your spirit for this very important ceremony that we are going to share in together. So that's next week. I'm looking forward to sharing in that experience with you. Well, it's time for the Word of God. I hope you are ready. We are going back to Ephesians today. And so why don't you bow your heads with me as we pray, as we get prepared for what God wants to say to us today. Let's pray. God, we thank you for the abundance of your love unto us. Lord, we want to ask right now that you would expand our thoughts, our mind, our heart to receive what you have for us, that we may move out as soldiers in your kingdom to bring glory to your name, draw people closer to your heart. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. Listen, so we are going back to Ephesians chapter 6. verses 13 to 16. We have been in Ephesians chapter 6 for several weeks now, so this should be no surprise to you. We are learning about the weapons of our warfare, the things that God has given us to be able to fight, to be able to win, to be able to succeed in this life against all of the obstacles and attacks that may come against us. So go with me to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 13 to 16. I'm going to share it from the New Living Translation. All right, here we go. You've heard it. You've heard it now. Let's hear it again. Therefore, put on every piece of God's armor so you will be able to resist the enemy in the time of evil. Then after battle, you will still be standing firm. I love that. You're still going to be standing even after the battle is complete. So he says, stand your ground, and here are our weapons. Here we go. Putting on the belt of truth, that's weapon number one, and the body armor of God's righteousness, weapon number two. For shoes, put on the peace that comes from the good news so that you will be fully prepared. That's weapon number three. And today, let's get weapon number four. In addition to all of these, watch this, hold up the shield of faith to stop the fiery arrows of the devil. In fact, many of your translations may say to extinguish all the fiery arrows of the devil. Today, I want to use this passage of scripture to preach from the sermon title, Fight with Faith. Fight with your faith. Come on, somebody, we can do it, and we're going to learn how we can do it today. All right, well, I want to read to you an excerpt from an article that was written in the Louisville Courier Journal this week by Hayes Gardner. Here's what it says. The chants continued, even as the zip ties closed on the wrist of the protester. His hands cuffed behind his back, he shouted through his Breonna Taylor emblazoned mask, "Say her name." The seated crowd of protesters, sometimes raising a fist and sometimes linking arm in arm as they awaited their imminent arrest for trespassing on Attorney General Daniel Cameron's property on Tuesday evening, chanted back, "Breonna Taylor." The man's voice faded as he was escorted away by an officer, but the chants carried on. They continued the next day, too, as groups of protesters and supporters cheered for the protesters after they were released from the Louisville Metro Department of Corrections. Since the protests began 49 days ago, 435 individuals have been arrested, according to the Louisville Metro Police Department. Those arrests have been a defining element of the demonstrations that have crisscrossed the city. When I see what is happening as it relates to injustice in this country, my heart gets encouraged. Because as we see these protests happening, we are seeing change being realized. In fact, it was just yesterday that it was reported that there is an investigation now being launched against the mayor of Louisville to examine his practices in relation to the investigation relative to Breonna Taylor's murder. It is encouraging to see that the size of the protest continues to grow, that the quality of the protest continues to improve, and the strategy becomes more sharp and more focused the more these protests and the more these fights against injustice continue. It's a beautiful thing to see how folks are learning how to utilize their voice and how we as a community are coming together to speak truth to power and watch how the systemic injustices and racism that plague our country are being dismantled little by little. And when I see what's happening there, it begins to beg the question as it relates to people of faith, how are we improving along our journey of faith? How are we growing in our execution and the use of the faith that God has given to us? How are we navigating our lives today that are different in a different way than we navigated them before? How are we utilizing our faith in a way that is more effective than in times past? And as I began to think about our passage of scripture today, man, this thing just began to open to me because I began to see how God is trying to help us to increase the size of our faith, the quality of our faith, and the way that we use our faith so that we can block all the attacks. Hear me, all the attacks and the arrows of the enemy. Because when you look at this analogy of faith being a shield, and that's what in our focus passage today, that's what Paul does. He connects faith to being a shield. He connects faith to being a shield. And that's interesting. That's an interesting use and an interesting analogy for faith. And here's the reason why, because often when we talk about faith, we think about action, right? We think about movement. But this analogy of faith is not one that is connected to offense, but rather this analogy of faith is connected to defense. Paul is causing us to look at faith as a defense mechanism that we can use literally to quench, to extinguish, to block all the fiery darts, all the fiery arrows of the enemy. It's a powerful thing to think of faith this way. And he's pulling this analogy from the very shields that he had seen Roman soldiers use. So, and if you've been in church a little while, if you heard me talk about this particular passage over the last several weeks, you know that the imagery that we see Paul using in Ephesians chapter 6 is connected to the armor and the tools and the weaponry that Roman soldiers had during Paul's life. And so this one of a shield is particularly important because when we go back to examine the shield that Roman soldiers used, man, it was a powerful thing because the size of the shield was actually larger than their body. It was able to cover the full entire length of their body. In fact, it extended past their body. The quality of this shield, it was durable. It was able to last through all kinds of battles. In fact, the shield was covered with leather, and some reports say that it was covered with leather and water in order to make it more durable during the times of battle and fight. The third thing is that we know that this shield was used in a special way. They used to form a formation called testudo, which is Latin for tortoise or turtle. And they used to form this formation that looked like a turtle because with their shields, when one soldier linked up with another soldier and that soldier linked up with another soldier, they were able to form a line and form an encasement that looked very much like a tortoise's shell. They were able to fully cover their entire infantry using their shields as protection against the attack of the enemy. And I thought to myself, wow, what a powerful thing. What a powerful analogy that we see here that faith is being connected to our ability to protect ourselves through the power of God from the attacks of the enemy. I know we talk about the evidence of faith is the substance of things not seen, right? I know we talk about that. We talk about we must have faith and we must believe. And often that causes us to think about it as something that we actively do, and we ought to actively use our faith. But I want you to understand faith today, not just as an offensive technique, but as a defensive technique against whatever the devil may be throwing at you. And I know it can get heavy right now. I know the things that we go through can feel like, wow, how can I even begin to bear all of this weight? How can I begin to address all of these issues? I don't have solutions for all of these problems. I don't have the ability to be able to withstand all of the hate that's coming my way and all of the lies that may be being said. But I don't have all of the ability to manage all of this. How do I do it? And Paul's response is faith. Because whatever the tactic is, whatever the strategy of the enemy is, whatever the dart or the arrow he may be throwing at us, the Bible says it's our faith that can protect us. I think that's a good word. I think that's good. And I want you to see that when we look at faith, there's three things that I believe this passage of scripture helps us to understand about the faith that we can use to help us to protect ourselves from the attack of the enemy. And in order to do this, I want to return to a very familiar passage of scripture in Matthew chapter 17, verse 20. And you've heard it before. Here's what the word of the Lord says. You don't have enough faith. You don't have enough faith. He's talking to the disciples. Jesus told them, I tell you the truth. If you had faith even as small as a mustard seed, you could say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it would move. Nothing would be impossible for you. Come on, somebody. Nothing would be impossible if you had faith as a mustard seed, as the size of a mustard seed. And I started beginning to think about this from this passage that I've heard for all of my life. Y'all, I've been in church as long as I can remember, and I've heard this passage all of my life. I've heard it preached different ways, but I started thinking about this in the context of Ephesians chapter 6 and under this idea that faith is a defense mechanism and not just an offensive mechanism. I started thinking about it that maybe what God was trying to show us through the mustard seed is how we can defend and how the Spirit will defend us as we utilize our faith, as we practice faith, how the Spirit will allow those darts to come, but those darts will not destroy us. Those darts will not hinder us from being able to move forward and accomplish the will of God in our lives. And so here it is. Here it is. When we look at faith as a mustard seed, and we look at faith as a defense mechanism, there's three things that come out. It's the same three things that we could see when the Roman soldiers were using their shield. It's the same three things that we see with the protesters that are happening with them as they're getting becoming more effective and they're being able to see change realized. It's just those same three things that will happen for us as we utilize our faith in the way that God has called us to do it. All right, here it is. I want you to see the qualities of faith that will help us in our times of attack and when we are feeling like we are under a heavy burden that is too much to carry. Here's the first thing. First thing I want you to see today is that the size of the faith that God has called us to exhibit will actually give us full coverage from every attack of the enemy. What are you saying, Pastor? I want to tell you right now. Here it is. The Bible tells us that if you had faith at the size of a mustard seed, well, you've heard this before. A mustard seed is really small, but it produces a great bush. It produces a great product from once it has been fertilized, once it has begun to break out of that shell. We see that the mustard seed actually is able to grow up into something expansive and something that is larger, much larger than where it started. And I want to help somebody today. I want to help somebody today. That is the nature of faith when you are walking with God. When you're walking with God, what happens is it starts off as just a little belief, right? Starts off as a little belief, but then something happens. Watch this. Something happens as you begin to utilize your faith. You begin to utilize your faith. You're saying, man, if God can take me through this sickness, wow, well then maybe I can trust him to take me through this financial problem. And if God can take me through this financial problem, then maybe I can trust him to take me through this relational problem. And if God can take me through this relational problem, then maybe I can trust him to deal with this career problem. And if God can deal with this career problem, then maybe God can help me with this community problem. And if God can help me with this community problem, then maybe God can help me with this national problem. I'm just trying to show you that faith grows in its size. It grows in its ability to provide you coverage against all of the attacks, whether they are personal, whether they are communal, whether they are national. Faith grows in its size to give you coverage against all the attacks of the enemy. Okay? All right. It grows. It expands over time. Just like that shield was able to provide those Roman soldiers coverage over the full course of their body, so it is that faith is able to grow so that it can provide us coverage over every kind of attack that we may deal with. All right, here it is. What I want you to understand is this, is that when we trust God, when we exhibit faith in the face of uncertainty, when we exhibit faith in the face of challenge, trial, and tragedy, when we exhibit faith, what I believe God does is he allows our faith to be shifted in that moment, so that instead of depending on our own ideas, skills, abilities, what God does in that moment is he says, no, child, I want you to see that it was your dependence upon me that got you through this. And if you can trust me here, then I promise you, you can trust me in this area of your life as well. Okay, so the first quality of faith that I want you to see is that it grows, right? The second thing is that I want you to see the quality of faith is that it is durable, right? It's durable. That mustard seed, when it's a seed, it has the potential to grow some 20 to 30 feet. My. In the seed, there is the potential to grow 20 to 30 feet. All right. In the seed, you didn't get it. I'm going to help you. In the seed, there is the potential to grow some 20 to 30 feet. Now, watch this. Along the growth cycle of the seed, there are many things that are there to stunt its growth. Come on, somebody. There are the animals that come through to try to uproot the seed as it's coming out of the ground. There could be the lack of water that is being provided to that particular seed so that there is a drought in the land. The seed doesn't have the nutrients in order to grow. There are a number of things that could happen along the journey of this mustard seed's growth that would prevent it from growing. But here's what we know about mustard seeds is that they are incredibly durable. They have the ability to be faced with all kinds of obstacles and still find a way to grow. They have the ability to endure all kinds of challenges and still have the ability to grow. And I'm trying to tell you, the quality of our faith that will really make a difference is that when you begin to walk with God is when we start trusting him to have faith, it will give us a level of durability. It'll give us a level of steadfastness that will keep us even when we see there are threats that should otherwise take us out. I want to go back to the protesters for a second because if you look at the situation, there's no reason why they should still be out there, right? There's no reason why this mass of people should continue to be advocating for justice from a logical standpoint, right? We have seen time and time again that despite our voice, using our voices, despite speaking truth to power, despite trying to advocate in Congress, despite trying to get people replaced in certain areas of government, we still see injustice reigning over and over again. And so you would say to yourself, well, I might as well give up. But no. When you have your eyes focused on what God has called you to do, when you are fighting for a righteous cause, then I need somebody to help me to get this word today, that when you are fighting for a righteous cause, I don't care what the obstacles are that may come your way, you must stay the course and say, yep, I've been defeated before, but I'm not going to be defeated the next time. Or I got defeated a few times, but the next time around is going to be my turn. I know it was challenging right through this season. Maybe you feel like that right now. It's been challenging right through this season, right? The last season wasn't so bad, but this season right through here, this one right here, it's causing me some difficulty. It's causing me some anxiety. It's causing me some stress. It's causing me some heartache. It's causing me some pain. It's causing me some issues. It's causing me some doubt. So this season right here, this is really getting pretty tough right in this moment. And you would be tempted to throw in the towel. But can I encourage you to grab a hold of your faith? Grab a hold of your trust in God. Grab a hold of your belief that He is able to do exceedingly and abundantly above all you could ask or think, and watch God bring you through it. Your faith must be durable. It's got to be durable. You got to say, God, all right, I know it's hard, but I'm holding on to you. I know it's difficult, but look, I ain't got no other options. I ain't got no other choice. I know that you desire for me to prosper and to be in good health, and I know that's your desire for me, so I'm going to keep walking that journey until I see it realized. I'm going to keep trusting until I see it happen. I know there's been a lot of people I've lost along the way, but I am not giving up until I see your promises fulfilled in my life. Can you holler if you hear me out there that God will do just what He said He would do, but we must have faith that is durable. So when the report comes and it doesn't look like you expected, yep, you may have to cry some tears. You may have to moan a night or two, but do not give up your faith, because it is in that moment that the darts that were assigned to you, the arrows that were assigned to you, can actually break through. I want you to hear that. It can actually break through and destroy the joy that God wants to provide to you if you hang on and walk through the process. All right, so not only is it important for us to have faith that is the size of a mustard seed that grows, not only is it important for us to have faith that has a quality of durability, but the last one is, watch this, is that we must use our faith. Okay, I know that's too simple. Don't miss the pastor. Watch it, watch this. It is not just, I think, where we are failing as a community, as a group of believers, where we are failing is that we are using our faith in isolation. We're using our faith by ourselves. But can you go back with me to the analogy and see that they didn't use their shields alone? That's not what gave them protection. They were using their shields with their other soldiers, right? So they were linking up arm in arm, just like those protesters. They were linking up arm in arm, and they were using their shields together. And that is what allowed those Roman soldiers to block all the darts and the arrows of the enemy. I want to suggest to you, it's not only that you gotta have faith that grows, that continues to increase in size, not only that you have a quality of faith that is durable, but then we must use our faith together. We gotta be able to walk through this thing and say, you know what? I'm not just saying I'm praying for you, but I'm actually believing God with you. Right? Right. What is the challenge you're going through? What is the issue that you're trying to resolve? What is the thing that God has promised and you're trying to get yourself in the position so that you can receive the promise? Because might I say with a little commercial break right here that sometimes what we are crying out to God for, the problem is not that he is unwilling to give it. The problem is that we are not in a position to receive it. And I would dare to say one of the reasons that some of the miracles and promises have not yet been manifested is because we have adopted, as Christian believers, we have adopted a very westernized way of involving and engaging ourselves in our relationship with God, a very individualistic way. But God has always called us to community. I gotta walk with you. I gotta be able to share in the journey that you're going through, right? And I need a brother or sister who I know I can count on, who I know will not just simply tell me what I want to hear, but also tell me what I need to hear, and then not turn their back on me when I'm in challenge, but then be able to say, okay, we work through this thing. I know you're not where you need to be yet, but I'm still standing with you. I'm still going to walk with you because we're going to use our faith together, because your faith alone, I want to say this, is not enough. I know, but it's not. God has always called our faith to be strengthened by those who we are walking on this Christian journey with. And so I need you to let, as we prepare for communion next week, we're coming up on communion. I need you to let some bygones be bygones. I need you to seek forgiveness and ask forgiveness from some folks, because sometimes the very people who God has called us to walk with, the devil has created a wedge between you and that other person so that your faith will be hindered and he can get one of his arrows through. But do not let the devil have his way. Do not let the devil get victory. Do not let the devil believe that he has got you cornered and the match is over. Will you demonstrate your faith by rising up and saying, you know what? I'm going to put an end to this grudge. I'm going to put an end to this division. I'm going to put an end to this issue. And I'm going to join arms with my brother or my sister. And we are going to walk the journey of faith together. And we are going to see God do amazing and miraculous things in this generation and in our lives. We're not going to let the protesters be the only ones who are seeing realities happen in the community. We are going to see the power of God rain down on our lives because we have chosen to put down our differences and pull together as one community, one body of believers, trusting God for more. Is there anybody out there who can just say, yep, today I'm going to use my faith, but I'm not using it alone. I'm going to use it. I'm going to use it in conjunction with somebody else, right? I'm going to link arms to arm. I'm going to stand shoulder to shoulder. I'm going to kneel knee to knee with my brother or sister. And we are going to walk this journey of faith, and we're not giving up until we see what God has said come to pass. See, that's how when the devil throws those darts, that's how you're able to block everyone, not just when your faith has grown, not when you just continuing to have a durable faith that continues no matter what's happening, but it is also when you are not doing it by yourself, then your brother or your sister is exhibiting that kind of faith too. So I want you to make up in your mind today. Will you hear your pastor? Make up in your mind today that I will. I'm going to let my faith increase by trusting God more and more. I'm going to exhibit durable faith by allowing God to lead me through difficult times. And I am going to link up with my brother or sister. And I'm not only going to believe God for what he has promised me, but I'm going to believe God for what he has promised my brother or my sister, my friend, my cousin, my mother, my father, my neighbor. I'm going to decide that this will be the season where we do not decrease, but we increase through the power of God. If you can say yes to that, I just want you to raise your hand. Raise your hand. Say yes. Today, I'm making the commitment. I'm going to let my faith grow. Amen. I'm going to exhibit durable faith. And then I'm going to use my faith together with someone else. If you can make that commitment, just raise your hand wherever you are. And I want to pray for you right now. And maybe even as we're about to pray, there's somebody out there who needs to accept Jesus Christ. You need to make a faith move today. And your faith move is to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Surrender your life to Him, invite Him into your heart, and then let Him lead your life. Maybe that is your faith decision today that is going to provide you the protection you need. Well, if that's you, I want you to just raise that hand, and I want you to bow your head. Come on, let's lift both hands. Lift both hands. Father, we thank You for Your grace and Your mercy. God, I want to thank You for the person out there right now that needs to renew their faith. They need to say, God, I want to not only exhibit faith for me, but I want to do it together with my brother and my sister. I want to walk this journey, not only believing for the promises that You have spoken over my life, but I want to believe You for the promises that You've spoken over the lives of those who are around me. God, I thank You that You do all things well. And today, God, I believe that as my faith grows and as it becomes more durable, Father, Lord, that You will literally protect me from all of the arrows, all of the darts, all the attacks of the enemy. Father, I also want to pray today for the person who's saying, the faith decision I'm making today, the way that I need faith to protect me today is by accepting You as my personal Savior. And if that is you, will you just repeat after me, Lord Jesus, I'm a sinner. I'm in need of Your grace. I believe that You died on the cross, that You rose again, and that You're coming back again. And today, I offer You my life. I give my full self to You, and I ask You to lead me and guide me. Lord, I know that You love me unconditionally, and I want to accept that love today as an act of faith. In Jesus' name I do pray. Everybody shouts, amen and amen, amen. Listen, I'm so excited that you have chosen to be with us today and that many of you have made decisions. And if you want to become part of this church fellowship, you want to be part of this community, or if you've made a decision to accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, will you do me a favor and go to miraclecitychurch.org/connect card, miraclecitychurch.org/connect card. And there's a simple form there. It'll literally take you a couple minutes, and we would love to be able to walk with you on this journey of faith. Remember, we were never meant to do it alone. So let's get connected today so that we can really have the full protection that God has promised as a result of our faith. Well, this is the time during our worship experience where we express our gratitude and our thankfulness to God. And many of you know that what that means is that we give through our treasure, we give through our talents, and we give through our time. But this moment right here is an opportunity to say, God, we want to give to You out of that treasure that You've given to us. And so we have several ways for you to give here at Miracle City Church. The first one's real simple. It is through our text message service. You can text the amount that you want to give to 84321. Again, that's 84321. You put that in as the number. That's the short code that you can use. And then you text the amount that you want to give. And if this is the first time you're giving, you're going to get like literally it's a couple instructions and you will be able to set up your account and then you won't ever have to do that again. And then from here on out, you can just text your offering or your tithe in. And then you can go to miraclecitychurch.org/give, and we have a couple options for you there. You can use PayPal using the email address treasurer@miraclecitychurch.org. And then last but not least, you can send checks, not cash, to 100 South Rockland Road, Baltimore, Maryland, 21229. Many of us here at Miracle City are tithers, and you should know that tithe goes to support the worldwide work of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but it is your local offering, the local offering that you contribute to this ministry that allows us to continue to do work here in the city of Baltimore and beyond. So I'm grateful for the gifts that you have been giving. I'm grateful for the gifts that you're about to give, and I'm grateful for the gifts that you are still yet to give in the future. And I want to pray over you as you give those gifts. Father, in the name of Jesus, we take this moment just to say thank You. And Father, I pray a simple prayer for every giver and even those who have the heart to give but don't have the resources to give. I pray for an exponential blessing to be upon their lives. Cover them, favor them, and bless them. In Jesus' name we do pray. Come on, everybody shouts, amen and amen, amen. Well, look, you heard me say it earlier, but before we go, I need to remind you, communion is next week. It's gonna be a beautiful experience that we are gonna share in the Lord's Supper together. This sacred time that we partake in our congregation reminds us of the great cost, the great sacrifice that Christ made for us. And so I'm inviting you to prepare your emblems. I talked about it earlier on in our worship experience, but I want you to go out and get some pure grape juice if you can find it. Get a matzah cracker. Or some folks have even taken the step to go ahead and order from Christian resource or supply stores to get the communion cups and bread that they provide. However you do it, just make sure, most importantly, that you are preparing your heart as we prepare to share in this very important ceremony and symbol together. All right, well, I'm looking forward to having that experience with you on next week. Until then, may God richly bless you, keep you, favor you and cover you, and may your faith be the key to all that God wants to unlock for you, not only this week, but for the rest of your life. God bless you, and we'll see you next week for communion.